You know exactly what I'm thinking of right now.
Boys, watch Confidence at Work.
Ah, crap, here she comes.
No. They say, oh, God, here she comes. if anyone knows what that is a reference to, put it in the chat. I'll send you some free gear or something, okay? I'll do something really nice for you. I know Red Snapper knows what that is. Thank you joining the Fighting Irish Faithful show. Really, really late. 48 minutes-ish late. I said we'd start at 9:30 Eastern. Yeah, right. Maybe if we lived in Labrador.
Toddler Irish Faithful and baby Irish Faithful had other problems.
Oh my gosh. It's just like the one fucking night I need the kids to go to bed early. Nope, we're going to be wide awake. We decided to go to Costco as a family, which, I mean, we're very blessed to be able to go to Costco and drop, you know, fuck ton of money on everything. You know, and it's, we have nice things, it's good things, you know, a third of it's organic probably, you know, it's fine. Although they have Christmas shit up, which is weird. So anyway, thank you for joining the show. People don't need to hear about my personal life problems and my excuses. You know, hey, I take full responsibility. Volume 132, season 5, episode 13. This is lucky episode 13. Thank you everyone for joining us. Joined with my co-host Red Snapper.
What's up? From the West Coast.
You've been in and out. You're better. Attendance has been better on the weekday shows, but on the post game shows, you've been AWOL, busy doing stuff. You know.
Day off and not home to just chill.
Not home. Not
do
home.
A podcast.
All right. Yeah. I mean, that's fair. That's legit. Means you have a more social life than I do, but that's fine. Although I've got two kids and a wife and a mortgage and all this other shit.
I just say single guy.
Yeah, single guy versus
dating guy.
Oh, okay. All right. So for the dating podcast, we'll go to Red. See the Red Snapper dating podcast.
That's the after
Red Snapper after dark.
Exactly.
West Coast Irish After Dark. Anyway, we are here to talk about Louisville. All right, but first things first, a little funny thing here. We're playing Louisville. What's Kentucky famous for?
Bourbon.
Bourbon. And horse racing, actually. But anyway, bourbon is specifically the true American spirit. Everything else is imported and just made better because it's American, right? Of course. Although I disagree with beer, chocolate, and waffles. Those are the best in Belgium, but that's, you know, I'll die on that hill another time. So I put a poll out there on X and I said, okay, we're playing Louisville. Do we stick with the scotch or do we switch over to bourbon? And I'd say it was, 2/3 majority by the Senate here that everyone voted bourbon. Now, personally, I think this isn't because of like people embracing playing a team from Kentucky. I think people's personal biases / hate for scotch was coming out. So, but hey, free Barabbas. Let's give people what they want. So we have Maker's Mark back in the house. Thank you, Kirkland.
Doc's favorite.
It is the Doc's favorite, although she doesn't really drink it too much. Although I tried to tell her, obviously she's nursing the baby now, so that's probably not a good combo. But it's not. It's really not. I was reading an article that whiskey is actually gluten free because of the distillation process. So. Anyway, we'll do some experiments on that one later when we don't have children that require mom as much. So anyway, all right, moving on. Couple public service announcements. Make sure you got set up. Where is the game this Saturday? Come on. Where's the game? It's not on NBC.
I honestly don't know.
What do you mean you don't know? It's a good thing you're co-hosting here. You can be. Are you serious? You don't know where the game is?
I'm in Tuesday mode. This is like podcast mode. This
yeah,
is
but not, you, if you don't have this down. Sorted by like Friday, you're gonna be fucked when Saturday comes.
It's Peacock, isn't it?
It's on Peacock. The game is gonna be on Peacock.
Well, I have Peacock.
Yeah, exactly. That is the sound of an actual peacock. So, don't worry. No risk of being pecked was obtained by that obtaining that track. But yes, the game is on Peacock. So get that shit sorted if you don't already have Xfinity, Comcast, or you already love watching The Office, and so you have Peacock, right? You know, whatever. We have Comcast, Xfinity, whatever internet, and so they threw it in with our internet plan. So even though we cut cable, so but yes, we have Peacock. So beware, reader, beware. You're in for a scare, Peacock. I don't know. Are they still gonna have Dan Hicks and Jason Garrett doing the announcing? Or are they gonna have some like B crew or something? I've checked my email. I have not gotten a invite to do the play-by-play. So that's not happening. Although I really think that if Red Snapper and I were in the booth doing the play-by-play, that would be way more entertaining than the shit NBC puts out there. You know who we should get, Red Snapper? I actually think this would be funny and really entertaining. And just don't read into this. Just go with me on this. This is all about fun and entertainment. If you and I were in the booth and we wanted a third person as an additional color commentary, of the people who everyone who does NBC, you know who I'd want? Johnny Weir, the figure skater guy. Can you imagine how funny that would be? Because especially for this game, A, it's on Peacock. It's already weird. B, you got the green jersey. We'll talk about that next. But he'll be like, oh, the uniforms are different. You know, and he'll bring that, like, you know, his own, like, influence, I'll just put it that way. You know, we don't have to get all technical about it, but like I think it would be hilarious. So don't read into that. You know, it's just obviously I'm you know, got a wife, kid, and Catholic, all that stuff, but I'm just saying, put Johnny Weir in the booth with Red Snapper and I, we would have a great fucking time.
that would be fun.
Yeah, and we're looking at an Olympian, you know what I'm saying? Like, so hey, he's made it bigger in professional sports than we ever did. So, you know, kudos to you, man.
Cheers to him.
Yeah. Anyway. All right. Moving on. Yes. All right. Peacock, drinking bourbon, green jerseys. Yeah. So it is officially the green jersey game. This is like an every year thing now with Notre Dame. It's not like a surprise like 2005 or the, you know, green jersey game from 77 or, you know, whatever, you know, it's just like, now it's like, it's a thing. It's we pencil it in, we put it on the schedule, and oh, which game should we do it? Let's do it on the one with that, what, that Peacock's also doing the damn fucking game. So,
are they going to have the LED lights again?
No, it's a day game. That's what's even more weird.
Very weird.
Now I will say this, the night game later on is Florida State. Now, before the year started, the Florida State game was like, oh, that team was undefeated, you know, da 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 da. And now that game seems kind of stupid for it to be a night game.
Dumpster fire. Yeah.
Well, it takes me back to 2018 where Notre Dame played and beat the shit out of Florida State. A terrible, I think, was Willie Fritz still the coach? No, Willie Taggart. Willie Taggart was still the head coach of Florida State after Jimbo. So, you know, like that didn't go well. So I don't know. The green jerseys has now become this like routine thing that we just randomly pick a game. I mean, like, I remember going to the Cal game, you know, 2 years ago, and that was the quote green jersey game. I'm like, we're playing fucking Cal. It's the second home game of the season, 3:30 kickoff. Like, what, like, what are we doing here? So, like, and it's Cal, like, we have no history with them, no rivalry, you know, I have no idea how they, you know, we were just looking for a win at that point, you know, it's just, I don't know, like, can we just stop with the fucking green jerseys, like, for a while? Like let's just stop. Like, let's wait for it to actually have some emotion and mojo with it. Like, just, like, scheduling it in is just, in my opinion, feeding in with the damn white and cheese crowd. I'm dead serious about that. Like, stop with the fucking green jersey. You know, if they did, if they said this was the green jersey game and they came out in gold jerseys, that would be even cooler. Okay, but do something creative like that, Notre Dame. Don't just like, oh, we have to do a green jersey game because people like it. Like, don't get me wrong. I actually, I'm wearing a green Notre Dame hat and a green Notre Dame shirt right now. So, okay, you know, and there's a green water ball like here. You know, it's like, whatever. So, green's my favorite color. My point is, like, the whole point of the green jerseys, in my opinion, and I'm sure many people, let me put it this way. I don't know anyone who's going to disagree with me other than people who aren't quote unquote real fans. And those people probably don't listen to the show, but I don't know. Like, I'm probably getting too worked up already. And I haven't even gotten into this, the spreadsheets here, and we're not even drinking scotch. So I don't know. Red Snapper, save me.
Save you from what? Talking about green jerseys?
I mean, honestly, I don't know. Yeah, exactly. What are we talking about?
It is kind of weird that, okay, we have the Shamrock series.
Why is this scheduled thing? We already have a schedule. Yes.
There's this whole dynamic about the jersey and everything else. And, you know, don't get me wrong. There's some pretty fresh, pretty sick white jerseys. And, you know, like, I get it. Is it just a ploy to sell more apparel? And I'm
probably
yes. Because the national crowd that is Notre Dame, and oh hey, anytime Marcus Freeman wears a new hoodie, holy crap! I got.
Oh my gosh, people are beside themselves. Oh, I have to have the Marcus Freeman hoodie. Who cares? So
you've got the Shamrock series. Now you have the green jersey series. Then you have anything coach related, like all of this stuff is just apparel ad nauseum. So
I'd rather they bring back the classic Lou Holtz, you know, hat and you know, rain jacket look. You know what I'm saying? Like, I don't know.
The members only rain jacket.
I don't know. It's just like we don't. Like, I'd rather go with that classic look, you know? Like, I don't know. Like all this other stuff is just it's a fucking circus, right? And people are just eating it up. Like, the Shamrock series, like, I got mixed feelings about it. And especially this year with it being 100 years of the Four Horsemen, you know? So don't get me wrong. I'm not trying to be an asshole here. I'm, like, as soon as that came into context in my brain, I was like, okay, I will take a step back from my, you know, bad attitude about playing in Yankee Stadium. You know, we'll talk about that later when we play Army, but like I don't know, just like this is like the thing that pissed people off about Christmas being commercialized. This is like commercializing Notre Dame football. We have to have a green jersey game. We have to have a Shamrock series with a unique, you know, special uniform that, you know, that looks like a blue gray October sky, even though that we're playing the fucking game in November, I'm pretty sure. So I don't know, like we're getting way too worked up over things that we don't need to be worked up. Can I just put it that way? I don't know. Or maybe it's just, I've had a rougher evening than I thought it was going to be.
For the record, we are Notre Dame fans. So we get worked up about everything. And, you know, I mean,
except Purdue. Fuck that team.
This really is the diluted, you know, kind of distraction play from actually focusing on the fact of
the dog play. The dog play? You barking in the corner of the
100%. 100%.
Send the number four man out on the corner of the baseline and start barking like a dog.
Are we really going to focus on the fact that we're playing Louisville and we got Leonard as our quarterback and I'm scared?
I mean, what makes it even more concerning is that if Notre Dame all of a sudden, like, last minute, the last 2 weeks, like, whipped out, oh, it's going to be a green jersey game. Oh, and the game's on Peacock. Like, and that would be a distraction play to, like, distract us from things that were already, like, pissing us off, like, on the turf. You know what I'm saying? That is not the case here. These are things that are, like, planned out and, like, people have made preparations and, something's been negotiated with Under Armour, you know? And it's like, now I will say this, I don't actually quote unquote know what the green jerseys look like. Maybe somebody else is, who's a little more savvy on social media and what the bullshit that Notre Dame puts out. Sorry, Notre Dame, you know, it's like, I'm an alum. I feel like I have a bully pulpit that I can call out your bullshit. But anyway, like, I don't know what the green jersey is going to look like. Is it going to be a recycling of last year's Ohio State game, or, you know, whatever? You know, just for the love of God, don't start crossing over, you know, all four colors of the Notre Dame palette. You know, you got the gold, the blue, white, and green. Do not put all four colors on the fucking jersey. Okay, pick two, like green and white, green and gold. You know, I would do green and black. I'd be cool with that, right? I don't know, like, do something unique that I think is awesome, and you know, recruits love, you know, whatever. Okay, I don't know, we're probably talking too much bullshit here. Let's move on. Can we move on? Everyone's like, please. All right, forgive me, Father, for I have sinned. All right, another thing that came up this week, Jaden Mickey leaving. I don't know if people saw that. Jaden Mickey is officially gone. I am actually, and I wanted to confirm this. I was like, okay, I saw this on social media. I saw some official kind of ish stuff. I went today to Notre Dame's official FightingIrish.com website where you can see the roster. Mickey's name is not there. So within 24 hours, he's been Control-Alt-Deleted.
Okay. Officially redshirted.
Officially, officially, like in the transfer portal. Like, he's officially not participating with team. I did hear from other sources that he is still going to class, so good on you. I don't think this is a situation where you have a Notre Dame player becoming a lobbyist or working for a senator or pursuing their academic career. I'm pretty sure he's going to leave. And what's interesting is if you go back into the last four games, you didn't see Jaden Mickey very much on the stat sheet, and that's because he wasn't getting the playing time. Now, to be fair to him, his mom just died last year, right? So I don't want to throw rocks here. Okay, maybe there's some other personal stuff going on in his life, so we'll give him for sure some benefit of the doubt. But quite frankly, that doesn't matter here. In my opinion, if anybody, you know, whether they have all their parents or one or whatever, you know, you decide to depart Notre Dame, okay, fine. Like, peace be with you. I'm not going to start, you know, getting wrapped around the axle. Kind of like I don't get wrapped around the axle around the whole Deuce Knight thing like everyone else does. Not everybody else does, but you know what I'm saying? People are getting really, really, really crazy about the Deuce Knight stuff. So, all right. So Jaden Mickey's gone. I'm actually kind of disappointed with that. Wish he would stay. I wish he would stay at Notre Dame, but I don't think he's getting playing time. Maybe he misses his family, quite frankly. I'd rather be closer to home. You know, we'll see what happens. So, good luck, Jaden Mickey. Hopefully you don't regret the decision. And I mean that genuinely, not flippant. Like,
Give him a toast. I think he deserves it.
Yeah, well, I mean, everything he's been through, he's been it's disappointing because this is a guy who's got a lot of talent, and I think really, really was embraced by the fan base, and now he's deciding to go somewhere else, and maybe it's talent, maybe it's playing time, maybe this is a good sign for Notre Dame. You know what I'm saying? Like, we got these younger guys that are coming in and just out there killing it. And, you know, like it's forcing him to second string, you know, like maybe that's what it is. You know, I don't know. I mean, Notre Dame from a passing defense standpoint right now is ranked 18th in the country, limiting their opponents to 135 yards, right? Per game. You know, I mean, we haven't played, you know, too many whiz bang quarterbacks, you know, so to speak, but Point being, that is where we are today. And Jaden Mickey's not really, really out there on defense, you know? And so either he's impatient or he misses home or whatever, but I wish him the best. We're not going to get too pissed about this. Red Snapper, do you have any reflections? I know you've been absent for a show and a half or something like that. I don't know if you caught our show. I mean, we did win. We did beat Miami of Ohio, and we don't need to recycle the game and the post-game show. But in general, there was a lot of Riley Leonard talk, which is our main stat piece tonight. So I'm kind of leading us into the other thing. But we did not hear Red Snapper's take on the Miami of Ohio game, and so I'm kind of curious what other people think.
Well, it was really the speed and pace of the game, and I didn't like how slow we started. And eventually, yeah, we got back into, you know, running back room, RTDB, and
yes, please.
Okay, it was more of the same. So it wasn't as productive and as much of a just bowl over game like Purdue was, which was kind of surprising to me. But at the same time, it was very much more of the same, and that's kind of what I expected against Miami of Ohio.
Do I
carry that same enthusiasm toward Louisville? Nope.
Right.
And I am very, very almost trying to psych myself out with the RTDB and just put your head down and run, and let's hope the offensive line is stout enough to create the holes and create the running lanes, and let's basically stamp U.S. mail on Love and Price's butts and run the ball 60 times a game. That's what we're going to have to do.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know if we'll have that many, the ability to have that many plays against Louisville. I mean, that would be like running the ball 90% of the time if you take the Miami of Ohio game stats into play, where both Notre Dame and Miami had 60.
I don't trust Leonard throwing it. So
yeah, and we will talk about that. Where I was kind of like being a pie in the sky, and then I was like, well, maybe he could be like these other guys. But then I went and educated myself, and y'all will hear about that tonight. But fuck, you know, like it's not good, people, you know, and I know that's probably what people are waiting on. I just saw John give us 100%, so thank you, John. All right, let's see here.
Why don't you jump into the stats? You might as well.
Well, you know, I kind of wanted to get some other people's opinion here. We don't have to cycle through anyway. Let's do it this way, because we do have a big stat piece before, and maybe people want to hear that now. You know, let's just do that now. And then people who want to comment, Red Snapper, I'll let you be the moderator and say, hey, you know, so and so wants to jump on and make a comment here. This is a legit stat piece. It took multiple hours to do. and so a couple things. Let me kind of set the tone here. So NBC and all of their wisdom, take that for what it is.
Sarcastic much?
Yes, that was a microaggression. We had training like 2 years ago at work. I work for a big company, right? So like everything's very PC or whatever. Anyway, we had this thing called microaggression training, and it was totally a backfire because it was like everyone was just joking about like whatever. And then the phrase macroaggression came out at work, where people were like, that's not a microaggression, that's a macroaggression when I tell you you're being stupid. But anyway, that being said, what's funny about it is like that is like, of course, trickled into my life, you know, because I work, you know, 50 hours a week or whatever. And I'm just like, and then I see like in other areas, like with my extended family and, you know, people I interact with, you know, outside of work, or, you know, people, you know, social things, whatever. And it's like, eh, you shouldn't really talk like that. That's kind of offensive. And, you know, you're, yeah. So basically, it's don't be sarcastic and be an asshole, quite frankly, which is not this show, right? But
I breathe sarcasm. I was in restaurants for 22 years.
That's so, right. Yeah, that's right. Oh, I'm sorry. Your meal's
not
going.
I don't know how to not think in microaggressions.
Yeah, but you're also a people person as a former manager. So you got to, you know, make the customer happy. You know what I'm saying? So.
Yeah, but the customer is not always right.
Well, so, I didn't say that.
It leads to your staff and you having extreme sarcastic bouts. So, yes. Yeah, microaggression, that's kind of a way of life.
Put a plastic smile on your face when you go out there, and then you can go vent to the cooks, okay? Now, it's fine.
Now, as a property manager, ooh, yeah, I graduated to dealing with it where people live. Ooh, yeah.
Oh, I'm so sorry. Oh, no. Oh, you signed this contract? Let's see what we could do for you. Yeah, exactly. All right, moving on. All right, stat piece. So this is kind of set up. So what did I say for my microaggression distraction? NBC in their wisdom had some stupid stat piece talking about Riley Leonard and had the audacity to compare his ass to Heisman Trophy winner Lamar Jackson. Now, I don't know the specific quote, so someone can put it in the chat here, but this flashed up during the game, and it was actually in reference to the Purdue game, but NBC felt compelled to, you know, piggyback on the excellent broadcasting that was what CBS produced and say, oh, when Riley Leonard was... and this is no knock against Riley Leonard, because I appreciate everything he did in the Purdue game. So don't get me wrong. But they had the audacity, NBC, to say, oh, well, Riley Leonard had something like the same amount of yardage and touchdowns or whatever that Lamar Jackson had in 2016 against Syracuse or something. Right. And it was like multiple rushing touchdowns with 100 yards and 100 yards passing in like the first half or something. Now, what's stupid about that is that, okay, first off, Riley Leonard basically played two quarters of the Purdue game because we were up by a billion, and he finished the game with 112 passing yards. In the same game that they're comparing to Lamar Jackson had 411 fucking yards passing, okay, which, a spoiler alert, is like 80% of what Riley Leonard's done this whole fucking season thus far, okay? So, like, we'll come back to that, but 411 yards. Riley Leonard's had 587 the whole season in four games, right? So, yeah, okay, check yourself at the door, NBC. Now,
he's thrown the ball that much?
I know. I was actually kind of surprised it was that much. Now, the real whiz-banger will be later, but... Riley Leonard did have three rushing touchdowns in that game, and he did account for 33% of all touchdowns for Notre Dame as a team, right? With his sweet stiff arm, you know, which was dope in Ross-Ade Stadium. But Lamar Jackson had four rushing touchdowns, one passing touchdown, and what did he do? I have his yards. Yeah, 411 yards passing. Lamar Jackson accounted for 62% of all the touchdowns of the complete blowout. Louisville put up 8 fucking touchdowns in that game, okay? So, now, Notre Dame had 9 against Purdue, so fine, right? But I'm pretty sure Syracuse in 2016 was a better team than Purdue is this year. So, like, look, NBC, stop. This is complete propaganda. This is a bullshit stat, completely random, quite frankly, and it's not even the right game you're talking about. You didn't even broadcast the game, okay? And I just think this is just the propaganda department of either A, Notre Dame or NBC saying like, well, shit, he's not performing at the level that he should be, which we're going to talk about tonight. And, you know, that. So I wanted to start with that because I saw that watching the last game and I was like, this is complete horseshit. You know, like what on what planet do we have the audacity. Like, comparing Riley Leonard of 2022 would be more, you know, relevant than comparing him this year in any game. I don't care, right? Like, it's, forget about it. So, all right. So that's that piece. No one has a question. No one wants to speak. No problem. We're going to keep pressing on. All right. Here's the real deal. That was kind of the warm-up stat, okay? But it goes into the details of what we're going to talk about. So a couple shows ago, I kind of threw in the towel and just said, like, look, maybe we're just not going to be a good passing team because our coaches are clearly committed to Riley Leonard. Now, we don't have to get into the reasons of why, but they are going with Leonard. Obviously, Red Snapper and I, before the season even began, we said, no, we don't think, A, Riley Leonard was even necessary in this team, and B, we should go with Angeli. And I still have that position. However, I'm also not going to bitch and moan all season because I'll just be miserable. And so I'm going to try to take the good for what it is. However, I made a claim, and it was the show titled Notre Dame, A New Hope, or whatever it was. And we ended up with some sweet Star Wars music. But it was essentially, we had the hypothesis at the end of that show, which was, maybe Notre Dame has the ability to be successful like three teams fairly recently. Last year, Michigan, 2011, Alabama, and 2009, Alabama, where macro-wise, they weren't the best at passing touchdowns in general, right? So, like, for example, Michigan, okay, they were number one in rushing touchdowns and really high, top five in a lot of defensive stats, but 42nd in the country in passing touchdowns last year. If we jump down to Alabama of 2011, that team with A.J. McCarron, I don't know if he had his girlfriend at that point or that was just 2012, you know, upgrade. But a point being, hopefully people get that reference. I know Brett Musburger does. Passing touchdowns, A.J. McCarron, or Alabama, really, they were 76th in the country in passing touchdowns, which is the worst ever since I've been keeping stats since 2009. In 2009, Alabama, they were 64th in the country in passing touchdowns, only 16 passing touchdowns in 2011, okay? So, you know, and which is a complete flip from the average, right? The average is, you know, 39 passing touchdowns total for the whole, you know, season, you know, including playoffs and whatnot. So I made the bold claim that said, well, maybe Notre Dame can live in this space of rushing the football, run the ball, stop the run, which is a mentality and something that I think fans can embrace. But I wanted to dig into that deeper tonight of where are we a third of the way through the season and where were these other guys that I had the bold prediction to compare him to, where were they four games in? So I went back and looked at every single, all four games that Riley Leonard has played this year. Kyle McCarthy played last year. I even looked at Riley Leonard 2 years ago because that's kind of like, well, how was he 2 years ago versus how he is now, right? It ain't good, by the way. Spoiler alert. We threw Lamar Jackson in there just because NBC pissed me off. But we also looked at A.J. McCarron and McElroy from 2009 Alabama, Saban's first title over at Alabama. So hopefully people understand where we're going here. We won't go into the details of every single individual game because, you know, I'll put you all to sleep, which is fine. Unless you really want me to. If that's the case, you know, just hit me up and I'll take care of you. What I wanted to know is, okay, look at the number of passing touchdowns these guys have had with respect to a percentage of the total touchdowns for that point in the season. So, for example, A.J. McCarron in 2011, four games into the season, Alabama had scored 19 touchdowns. AJ McCarron had only thrown for four passing touchdowns, so 21% of all passing touchdowns were attributed to his arm. Okay. We look at completion percentage, you know, passing yards per game and things of that nature. So rather than go through every single line on this, you know, let's look at the highs, look at the lows. First, let's look at the best of the best. So everything that's highlighted in green on my spreadsheet. Total team touchdowns. It was a tie between 2009 McElroy, Alabama. And then I also threw in here 2017 Notre Dame. Now, why did I do that? Because though we had 33 trucking, Josh Adams, and all that stuff, Notre Dame was not the best at passing touchdowns. And the stats here prove that. Wimbush was our quarterback. And actually, Wimbush, of all seven of these guys, if I include Lamar Jackson, which we're going to kind of eliminate here, but all six of these guys, McElroy, McCarron, Wimbush, well, I know it's five guys because I have Leonard on here twice, but Leonard in a Duke uniform versus a Notre Dame uniform. Spoiler alert, Leonard is worse in a Notre Dame uniform. I don't know why. Well, maybe people have an opinion as to why, but I statistically, I don't understand it. You think he'd be better as time goes on, unless he's nursing an injury.
Happy feet.
Well, and but why does he have happy feet now, this far into his career?
He's afraid of getting hit.
What are you, in the shower? What am I hearing in the background?
That would be meat sizzling on the stove.
Oh, okay. You're cooking. Okay. that makes more sense. Okay. Fair enough. All right. Now you're making me hungry. Thanks, Red Snapper. Where was I? Wimbush had the worst completion percentage of all of these 6 years that I looked at. 54% completion percentage. Now, Riley Leonard this year is second worst, 63%. The best is Kyle McCarthy last year, 79.8% completion percentage. It's fucking sick. Kyle McCarthy was not the best quarterback, but the dude accounted for 50% of all of Michigan's touchdowns four games into the season, which is really, really weird because these are like the shitty teams they're playing, right? East Carolina, UNLV, Bowling Green, and Rutgers. Okay, those are the first four games of Michigan last year. Like the first game that Notre Dame plays right out the bat, McCarthy accounts for 75% of all touchdowns for Michigan that game. Three passing touchdowns. There was one rushing touchdown by whoever, somebody else. Okay. So McCarthy takes the cake on these stats. He was quite stellar, which is annoying because he went to Michigan. Passing touchdowns. So McCarthy again had eight. The worst is Riley Leonard. He only has one. Riley Leonard from 2 years ago, 2022, had six. Four games into the season in 2022, Riley Leonard had six passing touchdowns. Right now he has one. Why? I don't understand that. We have better talent. Like, you would think it would be better. Is it Denbrock? I don't know. Is it the play calling? I don't think so. So it's really weird. Because of that one passing touchdown, Riley Leonard accounts for just shy of 6% of all of our passing, all of our touchdowns total. Notre Dame has 17 touchdowns thus far. It's actually not the worst. Michigan actually, believe it or not, had the lowest number of touchdowns four games into the season. They had 16. Right now we have 17, and Duke had 17 in 2022 as well. Pass attempts. Riley Leonard's actually on the high side currently. He has 103. He had 101 2 years ago. Again, what makes McCarthy amazing, I'm not trying to be given praise, but these are just the numbers here. Michigan last year only had 89 passing attempts, 89 attempts four games in with a 80% completion percent. Just stupid. Okay. Wimbush in 2017 has the highest. So maybe this is Kelly, which is weird because you think of 2017 as this high rushing, offense. No, Wimbush had 114 pass attempts this point into it. And Alabama's like in the 90s, right? So kind of in that meaty middle there, right? Passing attempts per touchdown. Okay, so this is a stat that people are used to hearing me talk about. Passing attempts per touchdown. So it's kind of the efficiency of how you're doing. Sidebar, Lamar Jackson, four games into the 2016, his Heisman campaign season. His passing attempts per touchdown four games in was less than 10. He threw a touchdown 9.7 attempts. That's attempts, not completions. Less than 10 attempts. Like, if you're rushing the football and getting a touchdown less than 10, you're doing something really good. He's throwing the ball. So, yeah, it's no surprise, that he won the Heisman. Riley Leonard's the worst, clearly. He has 103 passing attempts and one touchdown. So his passing attempts per touchdown is 103. It's really fucking bad. It's an order of magnitude worse than Kyle McCarthy, which is the best, 11.1. Now, Riley Leonard 2 years ago, here's where it's irritating, 16.8. It's the fourth best on this list. McCarthy's first with 11.1 passing attempts per touchdown. Number two is actually McElroy, 13.3. Then Riley Leonard of 2022, 16.8 passing attempts per touchdown four games in. Terrible. Passing yards, passing yard points. Riley Leonard is the worst. 587 total passing yards. Now, does anybody want to guess who's the best? It's Dr. Jekyll. It's Riley Leonard.
Yeah, from 2022.
He had 1,047 passing yards four games in. He is the best and the worst in this. How is that fucking possible? It is the conundrum. I don't know. Maybe it's Notre Dame Stadium. I don't know.
Pre-injury, post-injury.
I really think it's a post. I think this is a sport. We need a sports psychologist. You know, is there a liberal arts major on here that can chime in on this? I don't know. Now, we didn't want to just look at passing. Obviously, we're RTDB here. We wanted to look at some rushing touchdowns as well. The best is Wimbush. That's no surprise. He had 7 rushing touchdowns 4 games into the season. Riley Leonard is second on this list with 6. Red Snapper, what are you making? Bacon there? What do you got? I hear a lot of sizzling going on there.
Short rib.
Short rib. Nice. Nice. You just went to, level 11 there. Good for you. Lamar Jackson at 12, four games in, if anyone cares. He was doing everything. In fact, Lamar Jackson accounted for 75% of all touchdowns of Louisville four games in 2016. But rushing touchdowns, McCarthy had 0, no surprise there. McCarron had 1, McElroy had 1. Riley Leonard actually 2 years ago only had 2 rushing touchdowns, and he has 6 currently. Now, what's interesting is if we look at the percentage of rushing touchdowns as a team, rushing touchdowns as a percentage of all the touchdowns that have been scored. So, for example, Riley Leonard has 6 rushing touchdowns this year. Notre Dame has 17 total touchdowns this year. So, Riley Leonard, 6 divided by 17. Riley Leonard accounts for 35.3% of rushing touchdowns of all of Notre Dame. McCarthy is the worst, no rushing touchdowns. Second best on this is actually Wimbush, 35 flat percent, 7 out of 20. So And then if you do touchdowns total, which includes passing, so passing touchdowns and rushing touchdowns, Riley Leonard actually, with his 6 rushing touchdowns and 1 passing touchdown, accounts for 41% of all the rushing touchdowns. Now, it's not the best. The best is Kyle McCarthy, accounting for half of all Michigan's touchdowns last year. Wimbush, believe it or not, in 2017, also accounted for half of all of the touchdowns that Notre Dame had at this point, you know, 4 games into the season. The worst is A.J. McCarron when you account touchdowns he scored with his legs, which is 1, and 4 passing touchdowns thus far. A.J. McCarron in 2017 only accounted for 26% of all touchdowns for Alabama as a team. So, and then you have Lamar Jackson, of course, who accounted for 75%. Now, what's interesting here is if I think about Lamar Jackson and that Louisville team, they had lost like the last 3 games of that season. You can win the Heisman, sure, fine, go for it, but that doesn't necessarily mean that your team will be successful. Doesn't always have to be the case. But, you know, maybe I'd rather just have a more well-rounded team where you have multiple weapons rather than just, you know, 1 stellar guy. So I guess, like, what's the point of all of this? A little bit was, what is the impact Riley Leonard has now? What has he done a third of the way through the regular season? Is he improving versus where he was in 2022? Prior to injury, and where is he relative? So like, I make bold claims about stats, and this is me fact-checking myself. This is the accountability office here of myself, basically saying, like, does it look like Riley Leonard has the chops to be in the same conversation as McCarthy, McCarron, McElroy? The answer is no.
No, it looks like regression.
It's not only regression, he's not even sniffing the passing production for what I need you to do as a quarterback, or even just like being stellar as a quarterback, you know, going into that Joe Burrow, you know, Tua Tagovailoa kind of space. You're not 4 even
games
over there
in,
either.
Did we compare the national champion average 4 games?
No, because that would have taken way too long to do. I've got for the last 10 years, I only have 1 team on here, and that's Michigan of last year, right? And I don't really want to go down and because the season evolves, and in general, the statistics from the beginning of the season versus the end of the season are completely different because your strength of schedule is completely different. So maybe there's some mixed drinks here because in general, we're looking at teams that are not good, but like, and I was going to say this for later when we do our Louisville stats. But like for example, I was looking at Louisville's strength of schedule, which is not good. But then I was like, all right, well, Notre Dame, Sagarin's given Notre Dame a 37th ranked strength of schedule, right? Okay, that's not terrible. But our opponents have a combined record of 6-7, 46% win percentage of Texas A&M, Northern Illinois, Purdue, and Miami of Ohio. Miami of Ohio is a losing record. Purdue is a losing record. Northern Illinois barely has a winning record, and Texas A&M does, right? Texas A&M has the same record that we do, 3-1. So I was like, okay, we have a winning record, but our opponents have a losing record. And so, and that's probably the case for these other teams. You know, I mean, like Alabama's playing North Texas and, you know, this, that, and the other, you know, Michigan played East Carolina and Bowling Green. For crying out loud, Riley Leonard 2 years ago, their third game in, they played North Carolina A&T. So the statistics of looking at the first 4 games are going to be skewed probably potentially on the high side only because of strength of the opponent. That's usually where you have kind of your where you should be Patty the Sats. So there's a lot I've thrown out there, a lot to unpack. So, and we got multiple people that wish to speak. So let's go to ND Fanatics, invite you to speak. I'm doing Red Snapper's job here. That's fine. ND Fanatics, you there?
William, go ahead, man.
Or is William on there? No, I don't know. I don't know if William says he's requested to speak, but. And there's 5 foot nothing pod. William, you there? Says he's listening. Maybe the space is being trash. I don't know. If you guys are getting booted or whatever, try again. We'll try to invite you to speak. William, ND Fanatics. He was giving Red Snapper some trouble earlier. Nope. ND Fanatics is gone. Alright, we're gonna try to jump to 5 foot nothing pod.
Yeah, let's see if Paul can jump on there.
Here's ND Fanatics. You're on mute, man.
Hey, guys. How's it going? Thanks for having me. Good show, as always.
Yeah, welcome back. Appreciate you.
Yeah, I mean, I thought you brought up a great point, the Lamar Jackson stuff, and I was just looking at some stats while you were talking about that. And, you know, I think Lamar Jackson fits into a mold where we think of him as a rusher first. And then, well, Tim Tebow when he was in college in the NFL. And then Cam Newton as well. Would we agree on those three pretty much?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I'll say this.
Definitely. But the stats are showing Lamar Jackson's passing ability too.
Yeah, I mean, Lamar Jackson had more passing touchdowns 4 games in. He had 13 passing touchdowns 4 games in and 12 rushing touchdowns. But I mean, his rushing touchdowns were 36% of all touchdowns. His passing touchdowns were 39%. So you add the two up, you end up with 75%.
Yeah, exactly. So I agree with you guys, and that's the point I'm trying to get to. So in his second and third season before he went to the NFL, sophomore and junior year, 30 passing touchdowns, 21 rushing touchdowns sophomore year, total 51 touchdowns.
Yeah.
Junior year, 27 passing touchdowns, 18 rushing touchdowns, 45 total touchdowns. So even though these guys sometimes are pegged as rushing quarterbacks only, when they were in college, they could throw the ball too. Yeah,
they can throw the rock. Yep.
At a high rate. And it's like Riley's not on a trajectory right now to even get close to 30 passes.
No, it's pretty bad. It's pretty bad. Riley Leonard, and I didn't say this earlier, just because kind of like it, but it's on the high side. It's actually second best in this group. Kyle McCarthy, of all these guys I looked at, Kyle McCarthy had, and Lamar Jackson did not have the best completion percentage, by the way. He's actually one of the worst. Not as bad as Wimbush, but he was 58% on completion percentage. Riley Leonard 2 years ago was 71% completion percentage. Right now he's batting a 63% completion percentage. It's terrible.
Yeah. And I would just add too, if we look back at an Everett Golson, an Ian Book. Ooh. They at least had a connection with the tight end. They had an NFL caliber tight end.
Right.
They could get them the ball, and that was going to win you 10 to 12 games. But then when you run into the big boys, you didn't have any additional passing. They shut down the run. We know what would happen. But Riley isn't even getting that consistent connection with the tight end. So I think that's why we are very scared in terms of, are we going to lose 2, 3, 4 games in the regular season and not even be a question for a playoff?
I don't think that's the case. And the reason why I say that, and I knew this question would come up, and the reason is our week schedule. I'll be 100% with you guys. I mean, we are literally favored in perteamrankings.com every single fucking game, including this one and the USC game.
Yeah.
We are favored in every game. USC is the worst at 57%. Louisville, this game is quote unquote second hardest at 69%, like almost 70%. And if I jump over to what Vegas is saying, and we don't have Johnny on tonight. He got to me and said he was preoccupied tonight, so he couldn't jump on. I think right now we're favored by 6 points, believe it or not. And it's like, are you out of your fucking mind? So like, like Vegas thinks we're gonna do it now. Maybe it's because we're a house, you know, type team, right? Because we're Notre Dame. So, but even if you take away the bias, you know, that Vegas may give Notre Dame, it can't be more than the 2-3 points. So then we're like a 4-3 point favorite. So we're still a favorite, in our own stadium, which is kind of funny. But like, I appreciate what you're saying, but I don't see, other than USC and they could crater and we could crater and, you know, shit the bed, obviously, against Army, you know, who knows? Hopefully not. But I don't know. I don't see that there's no reason why we should lose this game. There's no reason why we should lose any game this regular season per what the numbers are saying.
Yeah, I tend to agree with you. I look at it more as like just devil's advocate and counter argument to like what the mainstream narratives tend to be. But, you know, to your point on the Louisville game, they've played two FCS opponents. Their strength of schedule is about 124th, which you already alluded to. They gave up yards to Austin Peay as well as Jackson State. So I'd have to think at this point that our skill position players can get downfield as long as Riley is completing passes at some percentage. And I don't see them, as much as they stopped the running game against those other teams and held Georgia Tech under 100 yards rushing again, they just don't have the skill position players we do. And this is going to be their first road game. So, yeah, to your point, 6.5, 9.5 point favorite. They should win this game. And I agree with that.
Yeah. Now, are we going to win because the game's on Peacock and we're wearing green jerseys? So, like when those two things are together, like the multiplication is greater than the sum of the parts? Like,
by your powers combined?
When your powers combine, I am Captain Planet. No, I don't think it's that. Hopefully people thought that was funny. Otherwise, I sound stupid right now. But now you say, is it Austin Peay or is it Pay?
That's a great question. I'm not sure. I'm an East Coaster with kind of a Brooklyn accent, so you know, pardon me.
No, that's a legit question. I genuinely don't know. I don't even know where they are. I had to look up where they were, and they were in the United Athletic Conference. What the fuck is that? So, they're the Governors, you know, that's not as bad as the Commanders, but, anyway, yes, you're alluding to the strength of schedule of Louisville. Now you threw up 120 something. Sagarin gave me 143 for the strength of schedule of Louisville thus far. Their combined record of their opponents are 5-8. So a 38% win percentage of their opponents, so significantly worse than Notre Dame. Austin, we don't give a shit. They're 1-3. Jacksonville State, they're 1-3. And Georgia Tech, 3-2, right? So they're kind of struggling there, right? So they played one Power 5 team, won it. That team is struggling. And two other teams, okay, I've heard of, but let's face it, they're not a powerhouse like Northern Illinois. So,
yeah, and I guess on a final note, I don't know if you guys already touched on it, but, you know, we have a core group of guys, too, that recall going to Louisville last year. It was the worst loss, in my opinion, in terms of not ever really being in the game. Mm. So they're going to remember that. It's at Notre Dame, as much as that isn't necessarily a hostile environment per what we would like it to be. Some of us, that changes things. And I know, even though I've never played at a competitive level like D1 football, you know, with playing sports at lower levels, you know, you lose badly to people. Like, you remember that. You circle these things on your calendar. And
yeah,
as an intangible, I think that will come to play as well.
Yeah. I do have my stats here from the Louisville game. And the one, I love comments in Excel, because then it's like I get like some of like the finer details of what I was looking at. There's one stat I would like to talk about that's the only one I'm going to bring up. If people want to talk about last year's Louisville game, we can. Obviously, we shit the bed. And you know, we could talk about Sam Hartman or whatever. But, you know, our yards per point wasn't bad. You know, completion percentage could have been better. You know, we didn't run the ball as much, but we got down early, you know, fine. But our scoring drives, Notre Dame was 27% on scoring drives, which is not good. We were 4 of 15 on all drives. Louisville was 50%. They scored on half of them. That's actually really good. But what's crazy about it is they only scored on their first possession after our turnover. Then they didn't score on their next six possessions. But Louisville last year did score on the following six possessions. So 14 possessions, they scored on seven of them. So, and if you score on your last six, you know, it doesn't, I don't care if it's a field goal, touchdown, whatever. You're scoring, you're moving the ball, you're increasing your margin, tightening the, you know, the whatever you're doing. That's good stuff going on there. It's up there with like third down percentage, right? Totally underrated stats, but scoring drives, hey, you march down the field, you put points on the board. It's perfect. Perfect. Any fanatics? Did we miss something else or what?
No, I mean, you just hit on a great one, because I just looked that up while you were talking about it, and I'd say one positive is in previous years, I mean, going back to Ian Book, those years, we struggled in the red zone. And right now we're 8-9, not almost 90% in the red zone. So, yeah, for your point, that changes last year's game if you're converting when you're in the red zone. And the one benefit of Riley Leonard being practically a running back behind center is he's going to find the end zone, or at least Jeremiah Love's going to find the end zone one way or another.
Yeah, I mean, like 2019 was actually really good for Ian Book. We did score. It's actually the best of Notre Dame, not necessarily per national champions or whatever, but actually this is better than national champions. Forgive me. I'm not trying to like zing you here, but if I look at Ian Book's best year, which was 2019, not 2020, like 2020, our red zone touchdowns percentage was 84th in the country. 58% scoring a touchdown every time we're in the red zone. The best it has ever been since 2009, since I've been keeping stats. 2019, 76% we scored a touchdown every time. We were 8th in the country. That's really good. National champion average currently 27th in the country in that statistic. If I just look at scoring, which includes field goals, again, 2019 is Ian Book's best. We scored 92% of the time every time we got to the red zone. We were 10th in the country. National champions do it 88%. The worst it ever was for Notre Dame was actually 2020, believe it or not. 102nd in the country. Worse than 2012. So it's interesting how there's some goodness to 2019. But I would also make the argument that, well, we did lose a couple of games to the good teams we played, right? We lost to Michigan at Michigan by a lot. Maybe there's some sign stealing. I don't know. And then we also lost at Georgia. No, that was a close game at Georgia, but the Michigan game was not, right? So, and we struggled against Va Tech. Yeah, I remember I was at that game too. So, all right, moving on. William has requested to speak, but I see that 5 foot nothing pod has joined us. Is he in the Homewood Suites, or is he safe in Corpus?
I'm in Corpus at my desk.
Are you
trying to upload my own podcast?
Oh, nice. Are you guys aren't in danger of the fucking hurricanes coming in, are you?
No, but I'm doing my best to find it. Jeez. I think I'm flying to Biloxi, or I'm flying to Biloxi on Thursday, but I'm doing this fun thing where I go from Texas to Atlanta, which I'm pretty sure if I do the follow the track your flight, I can look out my window and see Biloxi as I travel to Atlanta and then back to Biloxi. The problem is the hurricane is supposed to go through like that part of Florida straight into Georgia.
Yep.
If I would just go from San Antonio Airport to Biloxi, I would be nowhere near the hurricane. But whatever. It's the stupid airport hubs and whatnot I don't care for. Yeah. So, is what it is.
Yeah. Yeah.
Anyway. Some fun stats that I just got done talking about.
Okay. You can have a little teaser for people, and then when they finish they can go over the 5 foot nothing pod.
And you'll have to listen for a while because I eventually get to it. But so first of all, the whole Riley Leonard, Lamar Jackson, I didn't talk about this part. It's accurate. I agree. It's an accurate comparison. But for Notre Dame purposes,
stupid.
Well, it is, because do you know this? Do you know the last quarterback in Notre Dame history to rush for 100 yards in back-to-back games?
I may have this wrong, but I someone had mentioned Carlisle Holiday.
That is correct.
Okay.
Ding ding ding. So, if we're gonna say Riley Leonard is like one of these two, he is not like Lamar Jackson.
Yes, he's probably more like Carlisle Holiday.
Who, by the way, what position did he end his Notre Dame career at?
Wasn't he a receiver or something?
He was. Flop
receiver? Yeah.
He was. So, okay.
That's the Davey effect right there.
Yeah. So that's the one I'm like, all right, hold on, time out. There's two people that have stats that match Riley Leonard's, and one of them is not like the other.
I kind of want to get Carlisle Holiday on the podcast now as a guest.
Right. So, but then here's the one that I came across, I haven't heard anybody talk about it, and I'm in between offices. I had a 30-minute drive out and back today, so a podcast run through my car. I didn't even heard anybody talk about this. I made a joke that Notre Dame is like just a slightly better and different version of Navy. We run the ball and run the ball and run the ball, but can't really throw it. So then I looked up Navy's game against Memphis this past weekend. Does anybody know what Navy did to Memphis?
No, but I remember. Okay, so last night I did kind of my usual stat breakdown, and I saw some Navy stats, and I was like, "Huh, they're doing a lot better than what I would expect a typical Navy team to be." And that was kind of the impression I left. And I couldn't tell you what stat that was. So,
no longer Coach Ken's there, so you know.
Yeah, but that's not why.
It's exactly. That's not why. So, first of all, they won their game 56-44 against Memphis. Memphis is not a pushover, but I mean, they're not great. But you know who they're better than? Miami, Ohio. That's what I'll say there.
Yep.
Navy did Navy things and ran for 361 yards and 9.3 yards a carry. You're like, okay, yeah, that's Navy. And Notre Dame is not going to be that. I mean, we're good, but we're not that. But here's where it gets annoying. Navy threw for 205 yards. They were 10 of 14 for 205 yards. That's 14.6 yards per attempt and two touchdowns. In one singular game, they threw for more touchdowns than Riley Leonard. But hold on, it gets worse.
Mm-mm.
They had five receivers catch the ball, only five. And here were the long receptions for each individual receiver. Longest receptions in yardage, 46, 39, 23, 20, 13. Four over 20, two are longer than Riley Leonard's longest pass, and he only has three passes over 20 on the season, and only one of those actually traveled in the air more than 20 yards. So I make the joke that we want to be Navy. We have to strive to be Navy now. That's where we're at. We have to be like Navy.
Bad.
You want to know where Notre Dame football is at right now? I'm sorry, I'm going on a rant.
But okay.
Notre Dame football is where we have to pray Northern Illinois doesn't lose, and they did. And we got to run reverse trick fucking kickoff plays against Miami, Ohio. That's where we're at. Like, what? That's what our season has come down to? Come on.
Yeah.
Okay. Rant over.
No, it's perfectly fine. I think you're setting things up nice. It's the frustration that we're at right now, you know, and I don't know if I want to backpedal on my position about where we are as this team, because I don't want to be a miserable prick all season. Because here's the deal. It would be one thing if we were 1-3. if we had a losing record right now, like, just, you know, let's just pretend that. Why would we want to pretend that? But let's just pretend that. Then I feel like I would be more justified in bitching and moaning. But, like, we beat Miami, Ohio. And it's like, okay, we won the game. We didn't cover the spread. We didn't, you know, blow teams out like national champion teams do, right? I'm pretty sure people are aware that, okay, Notre Dame could probably run the table. Mathematically, they can run the table. We could finish 11-1, 10-2, right? Whatever, you know? Even 9-3. But, like, you get to a bowl game, like, I mean, obviously, if we're 9-3, we're not making the playoffs. 10-2, we're outside looking in. Maybe we get, you know, one of those 9-12 spots. Most likely not. But I do think if we're 11-1, we may still host the game. I do think that, just because I know everyone else is going to be a lot of infighting and other. It's all about your record. So it's still possible. So I haven't canceled my hotel in Mishawaka yet, right? You don't know what I'm talking about. You're new here. That being said, like we did win the game. You know, and it was a slow start. It wasn't pretty. It wasn't sexy. So, and it's like, look, we did run the ball. And we did stop the run. Like if you asked Notre Dame fans what would you like, run the ball, stop the run. Like, we are kind of doing that. We are being, I think, nagged with this other probing question of, like, well, wait a second, that's not good enough. Right? I think it's what we're getting at. And the bone I was trying to throw Riley Leonard in this coaching staff and this team was, well, maybe they could perform like these other three teams, Michigan last year and Alabama in 2009, and say, well, maybe if you're performing like those guys, those three guys, then there is hope for Notre Dame in this season to have a shot at going the distance. We have proved tonight that is no longer the fucking case. There is no fucking way right now, four games in, that we're even in the same stratosphere as those guys. Okay? And then NBC runs their fucking mouth and sinks. Oh, we're going to compare Riley Leonard to Lamar Jackson in some random-ass stat against a shitty Purdue team. Like, give yourself a fucking pat on the back, NBC. Good job. You made up a stat that has no significance. No one gives a shit, and it's made up fake stats. These are fake stats. Okay, can I say that? Fake stats. It's not fake news, but it's fake stats. Okay, those are fake stats. All right, ESPN's classic of doing that. You know, which then tells me that it's the Notre Dame propaganda department that's pushing that shit. Okay. All right. Where's my bourbon? It's over here. I don't know. I'm not trying to be pissed, right? But because at the same time, it's like, well, look, I'm not going to be upset if we're 11-1 at the end of the season and we're hosting a home playoff game. Like that's kind of where we need to be. But when I started this season, I said, look, I'm getting impatient here, and we need. It's been 30 years since we've won a New Year's Six Bowl. Get on it. These are games that fucking matter. Fucking play like it matters and perform like it matters and get your fucking quarterback situation sorted out. This guy is not even close to what he did 2 years ago. Not even close. And we're just fans. What the fuck is wrong with our coaching staff? Look, this is on Marcus Freeman. I don't give a shit if the Notre Dame Illuminati, the boosters, what is he, the Dick Corbett head coach? Who the fuck is Dick Corbett? I have no fucking idea. No disrespect to Richard there. I'm just saying, who the fuck cares if you paid Riley Leonard a fuck ton of money to come here? Number one, it was a stupid decision to pay money to somebody who was fucking injured. I said that was a fucking stupid idea. I'm going to come out here and that's it. All right, that's it. This is like when your wife unloads on you. All the shit's coming out right now. It's all coming out right now. Why the fuck did you bring Riley Leonard in, Notre Dame? Why? We injured him. We hurt him. You didn't look. We talked about this earlier in the season of how he was trending really high in 2022 and he was doing okay in 2023. Nothing great. But then he plays Notre Dame and there's a huge inflection point and he's never been the same ever since then. What makes you think for one damn minute that he's going to return to glory or worse? Or for better, depending on how you want to look at it, bring Notre Dame to glory. Are you out of your fucking mind? Are you on drugs? I'll tell you what, I've been drinking way more than you motherfuckers have, and I have the audacity and the courage to say, bench his fucking ass and put in Angeli. I'm changing the script now. Put in Angeli.
Well, hold on. I don't want to cut you off on your rants.
No, that was it. That was it.
Okay. Well, here's the thing about that. I thought about that too. And here's the thing. What is the most successful part of our offense the last two games?
Running.
With who?
Well, with him.
Exactly. So here's all I'll say is
against a shitty Purdue team and a team that's that has zero wins.
Wait. I agree, but it's hard to say, oh, yeah, just throw in Angeli when the best thing our offense has had is Leonard's ability to run and elusiveness.
But it's because he's not even looking downfield to throw the fucking ball.
Well, you're right.
I think we're using Riley Leonard as a fucking crutch right now, which is funny because he has been a little gimpy here. Yeah. You have Price and Love, two amazing, amazing running backs. Amazing. Probably the best duo of running backs we have seen since Josh Adams and Dexter Williams were both in the backfield. I would actually argue that these guys combined are better. Why they're both not on the field at the same fucking time at the same time is ludicrous to me. One man's opinion. Because we have not proved that. Why the fuck do you need another receiver out there? You don't need another receiver. Look, I'm with you, Mike. If you want to say that the strength of this team is running the football, damn, I'm with you. That is something I think, A, the Notre Dame fan base can embrace. B, this podcast is going to embrace. And C, that's what the fucking evidence is right now. You've got amazing. Now, there's a thing with the offensive line here. I'm with you, right? Let's put that aside for a second.
But then go to the jumbo package. Put in an I or a split back set.
See, that's my point, right? Like you're not even trying to help it.
Why do you have three and four receivers in?
You don't need that. That's a waste of a player out there that's ineffective and doing absolutely nothing. I'd rather have a lineman than a receiver.
Here's the thing, though. You have to have the threat of a pass. And I understand Riley Leonard doesn't offer much of a threat of a pass.
Another reason to put in Angeli.
But here's the thing. I just watched Angeli. Was elusive as the Benjamin Franklin statue in fucking Philadelphia when he had pressure. He got lit up like a damn Christmas tree.
No, that's because he was playing Sega Genesis, you know, NFL Blitz and
mashing down the turbo button.
Yeah, he had the turbo button. He had the hero button, you know, down. He's trying to make a statement. You know, I don't like. We've seen Angeli be mobile and charismatic and do his shit. Okay, he's trying to find a guy and whatever, you know, and that's one play.
Polk, let me ask you this question: what do you have more confidence in, Angeli getting away and not taking a sack like you're referring to, or Riley Leonard throwing a 15-plus yard pass consistently every game.
Yeah. Like, neither? I don't know, because here's the way I look at it. Okay, Leonard doesn't complete the 15-yard pass. It's second and seven. He misses the throw. Okay, cool. But he avoided a sack, missed the throw, whatever. And Jelly drops back, can't avoid the sack, takes the sack. Now instead of third and seven, you've got third and 13. That's what I like. A sack is detrimental to a drive, and at least, I'm going to say two things here. At least Leonard, I can trust that he's not going to have a negative play in that way that's going to stall a drive. However, if this is our offense, we're not going to, like you're talking about 11-1. Yeah, we might, and I guess we will make the playoff, but is this an offense that you're scared of? No. And then you're going to hear people go, well, Michigan just threw for 32 yards, and they ran for whatever the fuck they ran for, like 200-something yards, and they beat USC. I'm like, great, that's USC.
That's USC.
If Notre Dame did that...
I love seeing USC lose, so I don't... Yeah.
I know. I wanted to ruin their season and fuck Michigan, but...
I'd rather cheer for a comet to hit the stadium, but, you know, whatever.
Yeah. But if that's Notre Dame's, like, offense, only because now if we were doing it, if we went 66-7 Purdue and like 52-10 against Miami, we're like, okay, well, maybe this will work against a good opponent, kind of the way Michigan did with USC. But that was not a clean against Miami to where I feel confident that's going to work against an actual opponent. Like this weekend, I don't know what it's going to look like, what it's going to take, but this is an absolute Herm Edwards game. You play to win the game. I don't care what it looks like. If
I'm with 37
straight fucking times, I don't care.
I'm with you. Here's what's changed my opinion about this is I was the idiot here. It's not really, well, okay, maybe don't answer that. I made the claim where it's like, well, maybe we can get by with Riley Leonard if he's performing and behaving like these other three teams that did go to distance that were not good at passing in general, like with passing touchdowns, etc., right? And that was a hope I put out there, but I had no basis for that opinion other than just looking at, well, these guys were not good and we're not good, and so by association I was trying to link us with them. After doing the analysis that I just described earlier, that is not the case. All right. So point being, I'm with you when I say you play to win the game. And if we win out against Louisville, I really don't care how it happens. It's kind of like 2012. We didn't really give a shit beating Purdue by a little, scraping by Purdue, going three fucking overtimes against Pittsburgh. Does anybody remember that fucking nightmare? Because I do, because I was fucking there. I was there, okay? Which was kind of one of the best games I've ever seen in that stadium. But it was fucking terrible. Lots of wine was consumed that night, I'll tell you what. Point being is I'm more interested in what happens after the regular season. Like our regular season, other than like if Louisville and USC are the big, bad, scary, you know, dogs on the schedule, give me a fucking break. Because we're seeing Texas, we're seeing Georgia, we're seeing Ole Miss even, you know, like where I'm going now, which has been the foundation of this fucking podcast, is comparing Notre Dame to national champions. We don't stand a fucking chance against any of these teams I just mentioned. Okay, we don't. Okay, we go to a playoff, we go to a New Year's Six Bowl, we're going to get our head kicked in. Okay, and it won't be pretty. I guarantee fucking it. So I'm changing my mentality to go away from Leonard to Angeli, because we do need a more well-rounded team. We do need to have a dual threat. We do need to keep the opponent, you know, honest, all right? We don't have the offensive line that I think can push anybody around. We don't, right? Can you do you honestly think our offensive line can go up against Georgia's defensive line? Hell fucking no, right? And that's no offense against these young lads that are on our team. We love them, we support them, and we want them to do the best, but we're going to be fucking realistic about this, okay? So what helps with that is play action and having a quarterback with the confidence that I think could push the ball downfield, and it's not Riley Leonard. He's doing worse than he was 2 years ago. He's not even close to what A.J. McCarron and McElroy were doing, you know, back in Alabama days of yore when they were just relying on Derrick Henry and whatnot. You know, like, Notre Dame is not going to do well and get to a point where me as a fan am satisfied. You have to win a game of consequence, i.e. a New Year's Six Bowl in the fucking semifinals before you even get to the finals or even the quarterfinals, right? Like, you got these home games in the first round, then you got these, you know, quarterfinals that are like the Rose Bowl or whatever, and then you got the semis, and then you have the final. Like I don't want to be pissed, right? Like, and throw in and just, you know, like, shut the season off and start watching Netflix, right? Like that's not where I'm going, and I don't want to just be negative, but I can't ignore the fact that the whole foundation of why I even started this fucking show and why I started doing a podcast 5 years ago was I was looking at data, I was pissed at Brian Kelly, and I wanted Notre Dame to be better. And just because Marcus Freeman is the head coach doesn't mean I'm going to step away from that. It doesn't fucking matter. No, I think we're making a mistake leaving Riley Leonard in once I compared him now to these other guys. Okay, I was trying to give him a shot, trying to be optimistic, trying to be positive. And look, if the coaches want to ride with him, now, he can improve. Riley Leonard can improve. If he starts throwing the rock around and start in the receiving and the passing game starts getting open, we have a more well-rounded, balanced offense, right? We start doing fucking play action. I haven't seen that all fucking year. You'd think that would actually be, you know, appropriate given our offense and our swift running attack. Where are you at with that, Dem Brock? I don't know. Look, and Riley Leonard has the ability to be elusive. He's mobile. You know, he has some traits of Lamar Jackson being, you know, mobile out there and you know, can, when the pocket collapses, he can make great things happen. I want to believe that. But well, I need you to just do a basic three-step drop and hit somebody on a hitch route, and you can't even fucking do that.
Now, hang on. Or even the rollout to the right and hit a tight end on an out route that's 7 yards in front of him.
We lost half the people here on the space, but that's fine. You know, whatever.
Well, that's what I was going to say. It's my dad put it best. He's like, he's a great quarterback if you're not moving and he's not moving and he's like 5 yards from you. If there's any movement involved, you're screwed. But what I was going to say is, you're talking about, you made a comment about Den Brock, and I can't agree with that, and here's why. Did you hear what Freeman said after the game?
No, I don't listen to coaches' press conferences anymore.
Well, no, it wasn't even the press. That's the thing. It wasn't the press conference. It was right after the field, on the field, in the moment, and they asked him about Leonard and passing, and he's like, well, you know, we're going to have to work on some stuff in practice and, you know, see what he can do, and it, you know what, if he can't do it, then we just won't call those plays. So what he said is, to make it really bigger than what he said is, hey, we brought in Mike Denbrock, who we're paying him millions and millions and millions of dollars to be this really, yeah, really great offensive coordinator, and we have a quarterback who can't do it, so we're just going to rip up half the playbook. So, like, that's like giving a guy a Ferrari and he can't drive a stick, so here's a Toyota Corolla.
Which is exactly what I've been saying.
Corollas come in sticks, too. What are you talking about? That's the most reliable car on the planet. Sorry, Red Snapper.
His limitations with the playbook, his limitations with practice time, building rapport with his receivers, exposure with the coaching staff because of the transfer, because of the injury, everything involved. You want to take somebody who has limited time versus somebody who's been there, has built rapport, yes, has built yes, time. Like yes, this was my rant going into the second game, and it was ridiculous because the whole point of this is that he's an outsider on his own team. He's wearing, as the only offensive representative, as a captain, yeah, he's wearing the C, which makes absolutely no sense to me.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I think Mitchell Evans deserves to be a captain for him just because he's been there longer. And I'm with you, Red Snapper. I think this is a math problem. This is, you've had limited number of snaps, time, practices, what have you, however you want to slice and dice this, with this team and the guys you're supposed to gel with and be in cahoots with. And if you've been in a walking boot because you've had surgery, not to be rude to you because you've had surgery, but it's like one of those things where it's like, how can you develop timing with routes? How can you feel out a new playbook with a new OC when he's hired, you're not able to actually go live and run, you know, plays because you're in, you know, post-op recovery, you know, physical therapy. I don't know. Like,
run them. He can't even walk them.
Right. So, and then you got Angeli and Minchie and Carr over here who've ever since, from basically day one when Denbrock was hired, they're 100% Johnny on the spot, ready to go. And they're just like, hey, look at me. Look at me, Marcus. Look at me, Coach Freeman. We're over here. Hey, we're over here. We're perfectly healthy. We've been throwing routes with these receivers since day fucking one. And the guy who's been there the longest is Angeli, which no one gives a shit about except apparently me and Red Snapper. You know, I don't know. Like, maybe we have a bias because we saw him look good in a spring game a couple years ago. I don't know. All I'm saying is, like, look, I've seen Angeli. Like, and I'm not saying they need to, like, roll it, try to, like, look, if they wanted to have an experiment and say, you know what, look, let's roll Angeli out. Do it against Purdue and do it against Miami, Ohio. And they didn't do that, right? Now, granted, you could argue that was Riley Leonard's best games. But, I mean, time's ticking, man. The season's going on. We're a third of the way through the season already.
But I guarantee you, even that NIL money was not paid for him to run the ball.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Well, I agree with you guys, and I'd go further and said, I've even said, the way that Drew Pine just figured out how to win games until he went against Caleb Williams, who's first round number one pick draft, he made it offense work and just did just enough, completed passes. And 5 foot nothing kind of made an ominous stat that I'm going to reference. Carlo Holiday, the last Notre Dame quarterback to run for 100 yards in back-to-back games, also never completed over 52% of his passes. Ooh. He played Navy in that 2002 game when Notre Dame, I believe, started 8-0 with Tyron Willingham in his first season. You needed 15 points in fourth quarter to win that game. So, not company that you want to necessarily win.
William, are you in a wind tunnel? What are you doing, man?
I'm driving. Is this not a good time? I mean, I'm driving.
No, no, it's fine. When you talk, the
yeah, the, I've been having problems with the pod tonight. I don't know why.
Yeah, I'm gonna blame Elon Musk on that, or your cell phone carrier there.
Look, I want to make some points. I know you want to. This is about Leonard Riley.
It's supposed to be a Louisville show, but it's because we keep going back to the Riley Leonard thing.
Well, no, this is all Leonard Riley tonight, so we'll stay on topic of Leonard Riley. First of all, you know, I want to point out that this is just a kid who's trying to do his best, but at the same time,
yeah, he's a young man. He's a young man. The guy has more fucking money in his bank account than I do right now. Okay, he's a young man. All right.
I know. I know. And I know. I can hear how passionate and I know how mad you are. I understand.
No, I'm not mad. I'm not mad at
you're
him.
You're not mad.
I'm not mad at him.
You're not mad because it sounds like you're really pissed off.
I'm not mad. I'm just disappointed. Okay.
Well, that's translating to being anger, and it's valid, and it's a lot. Your emotions are valid. Because this is a culmination of 30 years.
I've got a microphone, I got a mixer, and I got an X account, okay? I am infallible, all right? Here we go.
Fair, okay. So, but getting to my point here is that we have to really put the blame on who it is. And it's the coaching staff. And unfortunately, yep, they did not do their due diligence when talking to this kid December 2023.
Young man.
Right? This young man, excuse me. Right? And then they didn't do their due diligence before they got the when they put the ink on paper to make sure that he was healthy. Right? So now,
man, I could have fucking told you that.
Yeah. So now we have an outsider, and I know the Notre Dame faithful, they absolutely despise outsiders coming into the program. They do not welcome them unless they're like skyrocketing right off the bat.
That's not true.
Come on. Now, that is true.
Okay.
That is
no,
why a lot of
no.
the hate is coming from. This is a lot of hate.
No. This is a performance-based situation.
That's my point. If he would have came off like gangbusters on the first two games, if he would have busted it out against Northern Illinois, we wouldn't be having this conversation. It would be all roses and happy faces. But the simple fact is that he didn't come through the system.
Hold on a second. We are very evidence based on this show. His passing
attempts. All right, let's talk about evidence based.
His passing attempts per touchdown four games in against teams with a losing record, other than two of them, right? But Purdue and whatever. He threw one passing touchdowns against teams that have losing records, okay? His passing attempts per touchdown in the first four games is 103. He has only 587 passing yards. He has his passing yards per game is 146 passing yards per game. That's really bad.
Joe, I'm not going to contest what you're saying because those are facts. But at the same time, I was getting to another point. The bigger point is that this young man has stated for public record with Peacock that, you know, he was scared that Notre Dame wouldn't want him after being injured. And yet, that's where I had to think about when we had this conversation a few days ago about leadership, and you stated that he's a quiet leader. It's hard to be a leader when you can't get out of your own mind. If you can't get out of your own mind and you don't believe in yourself and you're getting the yips are a real thing. And you can't get out of that mindset. It's hard for people to get rally around you, right?
So real quick, and then I'll throw it back to you. I want to set the record straight. I do not throw stones directly at Riley Leonard. I'm very critical of his output, but that doesn't mean that I'm throwing it directly at him personally, because he is a young man and he is still an amateur and he's still a student in college, which is why I throw a lot of rocks at this coaching staff and the administration or whatever, who actually runs things and who is basically giving him the keys to the car and say, and those are the people that have the opportunities to make decisions. The starting quarterback at Notre Dame, though an influential person, is not in charge. The head coaches, i.e. Freeman, and then the assistants and whatnot. Okay, so I don't want to confuse my criticism of the performance of Riley Leonard with me throwing rocks and being critical of him, the person. It is more
no,
the...
No, I'm not saying that.
No, I know, I know you're not. I'm just... I'm clearing the air for anyone else. I'm saying the coaches need to address this recognize this, and then it's up to them to decide what to do next. Now, we clearly have an opinion about what they should do, but I'm also at the point where I'm like, look, if you don't think you're doing well, like, again, I go back to the great, let's pretend we're in a dog fight with Louisville, which seems likely, quite frankly, right?
I've been saying this for weeks.
Okay.
I've been saying it for weeks.
Who do you have more confidence in, Riley Leonard running the 2-minute offense and pushing the ball downfield with his arm, or Angeli?
Are we talking about strictly passing? Is Drew saying strictly passing?
It's the 2-minute drill. Do you honestly think we're going to start running the ball? Do you think Denbrock's going to do that and Marcus Freeman's going to do that?
They have to pass. They have shown that. They've already shown that they will. And that's we can get into a tangent
on
that.
In what game did they have to do that?
Okay, let me back up for a second. Wait, hold on. Let's put a pin in that for a second, okay? I think a lot of boobers in the stadiums really do, unlike you, personally attack Riley.
No, I don't personally attack him.
I've heard what people are saying in the stadiums from other accounts, and it's like, God, this is awful. Because
our fans are assholes, that's why.
Yeah, and if anyone thinks that, we only see these guys, these young men, one day out of the whole week. The rest of the days they're being evaluated by the coaching staff. If Riley Leonard gets pulled at any point in time, that means that's sending the message out to the rest of the world that they did not evaluate what was going on through the rest of the 6 of the days with the team. That they're saying that they don't know. So if anyone thinks that Angeli's going to come in and save the day, it's not going to happen.
Why?
It's not going to happen. Because I just told you why. That means that Marcus Freeman and the rest of the coaching staff is signaling that we didn't read him right. We didn't prepare this guy right. We don't know what we're doing.
Well, how can you prepare him right if he hasn't had enough time in the system? This goes back to my earlier point. This is probably a really bad example. But if you're trying to like smoke a brisket, right? There are a certain number of hours and time that you need to get that brisket up to temperature that's going to, congeal the fat, get past that stall point. You got to wrap it in the paper, whatever you need to fucking do, right? Everyone's got their own secret sauce. This is where 5-foot-nothing someone from Texas needs to jump in. Actually, Texas brisket, you just leave it on there and it gets, blacker than coal dust. And then you just eat it, and then it tastes amazing, which is weird. But anyway, I think it's a math problem with him. It's like, I don't have a problem. Look, I am the first person to admit when I'm wrong, I make a mistake, or I don't know something. I'm taking my ego out of the equation, and do our coaches have the balls to take their ego out of this decision of who to start as quarterback?
I think the money and all the rest of the stuff that's associated with
those are bullshit. That's a PR barrier to an excellence delivery problem. That's a PR barrier to people who are donating money to what's actually happening on the football field. Is Notre Dame there to just get a premiere on Peacock? Or are they actually trying to win games that fucking matter? I'm dead serious when I say that. Because if that's the case, those assholes should not be coaching at Notre Dame. I don't care.
Well, that's what I keep saying is that if they switch to Angeli, that means they are acknowledging that the plan has totally failed. They're failing, and they're not going to do that. I agree with you.
I don't think they will either. I don't think they are going
to
make the switch.
I personally would like to see Angeli do well. I say that with you a few times, and
as soon as we went to the Sun Bowl, I was like, boom, Angeli, he's the man. And then look what he did in the Sun Bowl, and then look at the spring game. He did well in the spring game, and then we roll out this year, and it's like, fuck, we can't throw passing touchdowns. Why?
We had the built-in excuse with the labrum injury to sit there, and even if it was for a one-half trial of starting Angeli,
and he didn't do it.
They didn't do it.
That's my point, because see, you're just reinforcing my point. If they do, they will freaking look like they don't know what they're doing.
You
they
know
don't
what? Know I think the fan base won't give a shit if like let me put it another way. In 4 games into the season in 2018, I may have this slightly wrong, but I'm pretty confident in this. 4 games into the season in 2018, when Notre Dame made the playoffs under BK, Wimbush was in the first 4 games. Then, maybe it was 3 games, I don't know. Then, BK randomly, quote unquote, puts in Book. And you then see a dramatic inflection point in the performance of the offense, the number of points being scored, the spread, the overall flow, the third down percentage, pick a stat. Everything looks better. The offense looks way better with Book.
I think we can all concede that Brian Kelly was a better offensive evaluator than
well sure well sure well and I think
heavily on these guys.
Well, and I think that's some credit to that BK had, because he had been a coach so long, and he had been at Notre Dame so long. He's like, you know, like, whatever, you know, whatever you people want to criticize me about, I don't really give a shit. I just want to win football games, and that's fair. But then Marcus is trying to you know, toe the line and be the nice guy and this, that, and the other. And it's like, look, I don't want you to be a nice guy. I know you have kids, you have a nice family, you know, beautiful wife, you know, all this other nice things. You want to maintain this image. You want to be a player's coach. Look, all the fans want you to do is win and clobber the other team. That's all they care about. Like, they don't give a shit about how nice you are. You can be an asshole to the press, you know, which I actually kind of would like, because they don't throw the hard balls like we do. Like, just admit you got something wrong. Be bold. Try something new. Say, look, guys, this isn't getting it done. We're not, like, we need to develop the other guy and see if we can get to a new level. And if he fails, you know, then he can own that. But take some fucking risks and say, let's go with the other guy. And maybe Louisville is not the game to do that. I don't know. You know, I mean, it's fucking Tuesday night. You know, well, actually, it's Wednesday morning now. I mean, look, I want to be optimistic that Riley Leonard can be he can be great, and there would be nothing better to make all this go away for him to start to perform at the way he was in 2022.
And he won't until he gets out of his head.
This last week.
I'm sorry, that's his problem. He's in his head. He has, I mean, everybody wants to talk about the, you know, lack of time with Dan Brock and everything else. The kid, I'm telling you, man, the kid is psychologically blocked.
The game to have his break.
He got rocked a couple times, and we damaged him enough.
I agree.
You know,
at
the one game that,
you
know,
for him to have his breakout was this
last
week.
The kid's got to get, he's got to have one solid game, and he unless he does, and I mean, hopefully the one solo touchdown he's had has shown him that, hey, man, you can do this. He needs to believe in himself. But it doesn't fucking help when all these fucking boobers are on his ass. And if you don't think these young men don't hear that and don't care about that, if anyone – I'm not just saying
no,
young men.
No, I'm not.
If anyone doesn't think that doesn't get to them, you're out of your mind. They can say that it doesn't.
Look,
we know it's-
here's the problem. Here's the problem with what you're saying. And you're not wrong, and I don't want to be rude, mean, know, whatever.
I'm a big boy.
But you shouldn't have.
No, not to you. Not to you. You're a fan just like me. I'm talking to Riley Leonard.
Then you shouldn't have signed up to be the starting quarterback at Notre Dame.
Thank you.
Period.
Thank you. You are at the University of Notre Dame. This is not some ACC school. Okay, this is University of Notre Dame. This is the historical cathedral that is college football. That we as Notre Dame fans, this is a Notre Dame podcast, so I can say this. This is the cathedral of Notre Dame football, or of college football. Okay, granted, I'm the first to admit we haven't done anything worth a crap in 30 years. Okay, we really haven't. Okay, and if anyone wants to argue with me, by all means, you know, it's another podcast probably. We'll do a show tomorrow, fine, and we'll duke that one out. But you came, you willingly decided to come here. Okay, you don't think that our fan base is rabid and stupid at times. Okay, fine, but that's because we demand and expect excellence out of you. And when you don't do it, we're going to say, okay, next man in. Okay? That doesn't mean we hate you. And actually, we're glad you're here because Notre Dame actually is a friendly place. Get your degree. You'll be welcome. You know, like whatever, you know, this, that, and the other.
Excuse me.
I'm just saying these guys have come here. And now, in the modern era that is college football with NIL and these young men making fucking money, you know, with whatever, you know, and respect, you know, fine, do it, you know, do your thing. You are now in a different stratosphere where you're getting money for being at Notre Dame. Okay? And So the average fan, which I kind of am, kind of not, I don't know. We get a little annoyed with that. But it's like, well, wait a minute, you're getting all this money and you're not performing? Like, well, wait a minute, that doesn't seem right. Like, I think that's
so. If they're
a
getting paid like
response.
Pros, they should be treated like pros. Is that what you're saying?
No, I'm just saying that's a natural reaction. Okay.
I think that a lot of people's mindset is like, well, they're getting paid like pros, they should be treated like pros.
No, I throw most of the rocks and the disassociation I have dissatisfaction, to the coaches. Because, like, you guys see this. You guys know this. So why are you staying with this decision?
But you're going to look at the arena that is college football.
Which leads us into the Louisville game. If Louisville wins,
at the perennial,
I firmly believe Marcus Freeman is on the hot seat.
He won't be on the hot seat. He's got a 71% win percentage, for crying out loud. He has a better winning percentage than Kelly had at this point. I don't even.
It doesn't matter. The freaking season is. Season will be.
Who are they gonna? Look, I'm not saying they're. Who are they gonna replace him with? They're gonna hot seat. Are you out of your fucking mind? No.
Easy now.
You honestly think that Pete Bavakwa is gonna come in there, walk into Marcus's office, knock on the door, and say, "Hey, you lost to Louisville. We gotta talk about your job." He's not gonna fucking do that.
If I'm so wrong, why haven't they talked about extension?
What does that mean? What good did that do Kelly, for crying out loud? Gee whiz, he gets an extension and he goes a 4-8 season.
Well, you know, Will brought up a good point earlier on this note, and I agree with you, Irish Faithful. Brian Kelly was in his seventh year as a head coach in D1 football when he took over Notre Dame.
Which is why he should have been fired in 2016 when he went 4-8, but that's a whole other topic, but...
This is year three for Marcus Freeman.
As a head coach, period.
Exactly. Period. Because Brian Kelly was coaching at the lower levels, Grand Valley State, and I forgot what else.
But he was still a head coach.
Exactly. This is year three for him being a head coach. And he is the defensive side of the ball.
You went to Mecca to be the head coach. Like, what the fuck?
Bingo. And he's a defensive guy. And his defensive units has been strong.
They've Brian been great.
Kelly, he's an offensive mind, and they weren't ever the best unit on the team. Very rarely. He finally hired a good DC and Mike Elko. Then he hired Clark Lee, and then he hired Marcus Freeman. And they always were the better units. The offense was what lagged behind. Now, Freeman's got to figure out the offensive side of the ball, but let's not kid ourselves again, as you just mentioned in piggyback and, you know, supplemented my information. Marcus Freeman defense has been stellar.
Yep.
But he's got to figure out the offensive side of the ball. And the same way that Brian Kelly struggled in hiring a defensive coordinator, and we saw when those defenses were poor and how those teams struggled. And that was a coach that had 20 years of head coaching experience. Now, if you want to say that Marcus Freeman was in over his head, that may be the case, but
and that's another reason why I say he's going to be on the hot seat, guys. I'm just trying to point out the facts. When you lose against teams like Marshall, and you lose against Stanford, and you lose against Northern Illinois, after a while you see a pattern, and the people Vaca is no fool. He knows that, you know, he's got to produce something. We've been in a drought for 30 years for a New Year's game. We're not even talking about BCS or any kind of championship. We're just talking about a bowl that matters.
Yep.
He knows. People Vaca knows that the fan base is at its limit. It's really at its limit. If you look at the last time we won a championship, okay, and deduct and use the time between now and then, that's over 30 years, correct? Well, if you just subtract from the 30 years from that point, 89, we won, I think, three championships in that span. Three. I remember the 70s and the third championship in the 80s because I lived through it. I saw it, and that's what I built my loyalty over. And after the 30 years of this, Pete Vaca, who says is a self-proclaimed Notre Dame fan, he knows the fan base is at its limits. If Marcus Freeman does not win against Louisville, the season is over, fellas. We're going to be like standing around with like Pete, like whatchamacallit from the Indianapolis Colts playoffs. Nobody's going to care.
Yeah,
the fan base will leave. The fan base will just say, you know what, these guys don't know what they're doing.
No, they won't, yeah. Because Notre Dame is an annuity, right? They got all this Under Armour shit, you know, like the Notre Dame's fans are pretty loyal, like. They won't leave. Like it, you'd have to have like we survived Weiss with 3-9 and all the 6-6 and, you know, 7-5, you know, bullshit there. You know what I'm saying? Like after Weiss comes in and Bellas, flashes his ring, like how is this different?
Because we've endured the Bob Davies, the Weisses, the Willinghams. You know, and it's over. As somebody in his 50s, I'm sick of it.
No, and I'm with you. Let me pose this. If it's not so much a function of like, you know, the sands of time, that now that it's like 30 years since we've won a New Year's Six and 34 years since we've won a title. Or longer, 36? I don't know. I can't do the math that well.
35
now, right? Yeah. The 88 season, but whatever. The maybe it's a function not so much of like time, whereas it's a function of the new AD is just like, look, I'm the athletic director. It's my name on the legacy that is now Notre Dame football as the athletic director. And so I need to drop a hammer and do things the way I want to and hire the people I want to and have this program output in the way that I think it needs to be. Because let's face it, the athletic director who hired Marcus Freeman and the president of the university that hired Marcus Freeman is not these are not the same people now.
No, they're not.
So and that's not to say we don't want Marcus Freeman. That's not to say that these guys don't like Marcus Freeman and want him to stay. I guarantee you that P compete and whatnot, they want him to be successful. And they want him to succeed. But they also recognize that, look, are we going to be like Boston College and just have a ho-hum football team and, you know, sell merchandise for Shamrock Series shit? Or do we actually want to win something that fucking matters and bring in the real money and bring Notre Dame back to college football prominence?
Well, that's where we are now. I hate to tell you, fellas, that's where we are now. Let's put our cards on the table. Let's call it as it is. That's where we are now. You even just said it. There's no way we're going to square up with Texas or UG or Alabama. There is no way.
So why would you keep Riley Leonard in there?
Well, the one thing I want to say, I mean, William, you're a little bit older than me, but I also remember during Ty and Bobby Davey years, we didn't win a bowl game. There was a bowl game winless streak that Charlie Weiss had to go to the Hawaii Bowl and beat Hawaii and finally break that Hawaii Bowl streak. So there's been worse times. Now, we have leveled up, and we expect now to level up to be a championship contender, which I do agree with, and we're frustrated. But at the same time, Georgia had a 40-year win streak between the time that they beat Notre Dame in 1980. Michigan hadn't won a consensus national title for 70-plus years. So to think at 36 that the sky is falling – it sucks. We're frustrated. It's long overdue, but it's not the end of the world. I think that's a little hyperbole.
I'm not trying to say it's over. And to get back on your point about, you know, Bob Davies and everything, well, I hold the administration squarely responsible for Davey and Weiss and Willingham because they didn't take football seriously. They weren't.
Right.
All right. I will give it. Hey, look. The Notre Dame of today is trying. They're trying. I agree. Okay? I will give them that. But the problem is, Jack was a lawyer. He was not a football guy.
So is Pete.
Yeah, but I don't know. I think Jack, I don't know. I don't know. Something about Jack never fit well with me. I don't know. I can't explain it. Maybe it's like total BS. I don't know. All I'm saying is that the Notre Dame of today is light years ahead of where Bob Davies' Notre Dame is. Okay, I will concede that. I will concede that to the day I die. But the thing is that we are not, and for whatever reason, Jack chose a inexperienced coach to try to bring us into the 21st century. That was the wrong thing to do. I really love Marcus Freeman, but he's probably a better defensive coordinator than he is as a head coach.
You open the box.
I don't care. We need to be honest with each other. We need to be honest with each other as a fan base. Because the truth of the matter is that look what's been going on the last 3 years. Okay.
William, let Red Snapper rebuttal.
I want everyone to come in. Come on in.
So the one thing that I want to point out that's very glaringly obvious to me, being how old I am at 44 years of age,
knowing
the mentality of the 88 season. That team did not have the most talent. They were not favored to win the title that year. So the mentality of the whole thing is simply that was a team that was able to build itself through cohesion and camaraderie. If you have any chance of being more than the sum of your parts, it's because of the team cohesion mentality of all for one, and you're going to die for the guy that lines up next to you, and you're going to know what he does before he does it because you have practiced the same play over and over again, so you can tell what he's going to do by the way he breathes. The problem I have is you don't have that when you have a quarterback who doesn't have any cohesion with the rest of his offense.
Yeah, I'm with Red Snapper on that one. I would so like if to
you,
get
you want oh. the best chance of anybody. It's going to be the guy that has been there in the weight room, in the film room, at practice, at spring ball, at spring games, year after year, and is diehard Notre Dame, is absolutely invested with every other player on that team. And that's the problem I have, is right now we are not leaning toward cohesion as a team. We're leaning toward who's got the biggest NIL check.
And yeah, frankly, and that's bullshit.
I don't give a shit. Don't give a shit.
I want to get our director of marketing, Justin Cates, Uncle June, on here. He's been trying to get on here. So, Uncle June, if you can come on here and respond to this and or just chime in. I mean, I feel like this is like the eighth show in a row we're talking about Riley Leonard. But it's a hot point of contention because I'm not saying that Notre Dame's is at a crossroads this Saturday on Peacock with our green jerseys against Louisville. But it kind of feels that way, that especially the way this show's gone on and the I don't want to say infighting, but this is like a family argument, you know, like we're all on the same team. We all want Notre Dame to win. Right. So we all, you know, are supporting each other in some weird way, but we're also like, you know, like it's like a family argument. So Uncle June, you there? You're on mute.
Yeah, I'm here. Can you hear me?
Yeah. Loud and clear. Go for it. Floor is yours.
Red Snapper. Red Snapper, God bless you. What you said is right. We've had five different quarterbacks in 5 years.
Yep.
That's a big issue. That's not going to get it done. That's like getting new offensive coordinators constantly.
Yep. Third OC in 3 years.
Yeah, it's a nightmare. As far as the hot seat, I'm with you. You can't fire Freeman unless you have a home run hire lined up.
Nope. I mean,
Notre Dame's crapped the bed in the situation before.
Yeah.
You know, O'Leary, you know, Urban Meyer, all those guys. We'll get him, you know, and Pete has to know. He has to learn. I also don't think Marcus is a finished product as a head coach.
No, he's definitely
not. No one will know. You know, so it's hard for me to say, Brian Kelly is a better head coach. I don't know. Who knows? This guy's in his infant stages, and he has more charisma in his pinky than Brian Kelly's ever had. He's the best recruiting head coach we've ever had.
Yes.
So no matter what happens, if Marcus Freeman gets canned in 3 years, the roster will be loaded, and there'll be something here. Let me go on to Riley Leonard now, okay?
Sure.
Cry me a river, Riley Leonard, okay? You get booed. I'm sorry. This guy's mom sends him text messages that he sucks. That's a real thing because he has a big head, okay? He calls himself an alpha competitor, okay? I don't cry for him when he struggles. I'm like, if I sucked at my job and I got $2 million or $1 million, I would be really sad that I stuck at it, but I'd probably have a nice meal at Ruth Chris and forget about all the a-holes who booed me at the game. You know,
We had a nice vacation in Maui. It was great.
Yeah, it's good. You know, do I boo? No, no, but they know what it is. The other thing I want to, this is not directed towards a particular person because I've heard multiple people say it. When people say he has the yips, that's such horseshit. Yips are something when you are automatic at something, like Chuck Knoblauch throwing the ball to first base your whole life, and all of a sudden you can't make that throw. That's the yips. Riley Leonard has never been automatic throwing the ball downfield in his whole career.
Interesting.
It's not the yips. It is what he is. That's the thing. So when I heard someone say earlier yesterday, oh, well, he's just in his head about it. He's never done it.
Yeah.
He's in his head about it because he may not be capable of it. And he's never been like, I can make that throw. Because he's never really made it consistently.
And we kind of talked about that, like, going back to the recruiting. Obviously, I knew he was a basketball guy, but, like, that's the whole point. Like, look, this is Notre Dame. This is Notre Dame football, and you're gonna hitch your wagon to someone who was, like, in the 50s or whatever in his recruiting class? You know, like, I don't know. Like, so, continued, Coach.
And I'll just, you know, this is the thing, and it's bothered me. I think people get tired of me hearing me say this. The solution to this was Andy Ludwig. You know, who? Was Andy Ludwig was the offensive coordinator at Utah, who Notre Dame brought in. They brought him out at a hockey game, and then yes. They wouldn't pay his buyout.
Yeah.
You want to know who you don't want to get in a fist fight with of any team? You know, you don't want to be in a fist fight with Georgia either. You want to play Utah? That's not a fun game. And if you're Notre Dame, you want to win in the trenches. You want to run the ball. He's your guy. And I think Denbrock's great. But you get Ludwig after Reese leaves, and guess what? We don't have to worry about, you know, you ask Andy Ludwig, hey, do you want Riley Leonard? He says, I don't care. We have Julian Love and Jadarian Price and Aeneas Williams. And we have a good offensive line. That's all. I'm good with that. I'll take an 11th year quarterback with a crazy 70s porno mustache and make him, you know, the greatest thing Utah's ever seen. So, you know, I feel like it's a hybrid of administration and some coaching things, but, you know, it's maddening. And I do think Marcus is at a crossroads. And I, you know, to be honest, I think they'll probably win on Saturday just because that's sort of how it seems to go.
I think so too. We're gonna end on that.
Yeah. So, but yeah, that's it. I appreciate you, man. Always get your stuff on Etsy that doesn't exist anymore.
we should. I feel like I should put some up just to give a middle finger to the Notre Dame Notre Dame police that apparently don't like our name Fighting Irish Faithful because they claim we're violating copyright. No, we're not, but we're not also in a position where we would desire to go against the legal system that is Notre Dame football. So whatever.
They are a little bit litigious.
Fighting Irish Faithful, on this tangent, I just want to let you know, they sued a high school and took away their leprechaun logo, so it's not just you, they're really petty.
I don't have the leprechaun anymore, I got rid of that shit. It's the name. They don't like Fighting Irish Faithful. Even though Notre Dame's official copyright name is the Fightin', no G, Fightin' Irish. That's it. I'm Fighting Irish Faithful. Those are not the same fucking thing. So fuck you, Notre Dame marketing, whatever people, like, whatever, you know, like if people really want shit, like just people know me, you know, we can do stuff. But anyway, yeah, no, I appreciate Justin Cates there. Thank you. Our director of marketing here for the show. Yeah, well, some high-level stats. So we talked about strength of schedule earlier. Louisville, 143 on Sagarin. Notre Dame, 37. Sagarin's putting Notre Dame at 8th, actually. Louisville at 19th. AP, coaches poll, whatever. Okay, fine. Look, Louisville hasn't really played anybody. I mean, they played Georgia Tech, I guess, but, you know, Austin Peay, Jacksonville State, that's it. Like, give me a break. Now, there is that's not to take anything away from what they have done, because a lot of where they succeed, they exceed Notre Dame quite greatly. I mean, for example, completion percentage, they're 9th in the country. Third down defense, they're actually better than Notre Dame. Sacks per game, they average 3 a game. We average 2.25, you know, et cetera, et cetera. You know, so there are many things they do well. What's interesting is if I look at you know, the average stats that I like talking about, yards per point, they're better. Passing attempts per touchdown, they're better. But rushing attempts per touchdown, we are better. Now, maybe that's a Riley Leonard thing. I don't know. But Jeff Brohm, okay, fine. You have a 76% win percentage at Louisville, which is fine. You're a Louisville guy, but you're as a head coach, including your time at Purdue, maybe this is a Purdue anchor here, but as a coach, you're 62%. Marcus Freeman, despite a lot of the rocks we've thrown at him tonight, 71%. And we have better players. We have better four-year recruiting average, 9.3 versus their 44.3. So I do think Notre Dame will win. Now, I don't know about the spread. I think it's going to be close. I get real nervous when I think about Notre Dame in a close game with Riley Leonard.
But, you know, Marcus Freeman has a much better head of hair than Jeff Brohm. So,
well, and I think Marcus Freeman has, I mean, he's gone to Louisville and lost. He's had an embarrassing loss at Ohio. Like we should have fucking won that Ohio State game last year. We should have won. There were so many opportunities for us to, if one of those things, anything from kicking a field goal instead of going up for on fourth, to having 11 people on the field instead of 10 people, instead of, you know, throwing a bunch of fucking passing plays at the end of the game instead of running the football, you know, and punting everywhere. Getting an interception on defense rather than, you know, fucking missing it. You know, just there's so many little things in the Ohio State game last year that have got to keep him up late at night to about, you know, hey, shit, we should have done better. So I think that Marcus Freeman has been through more. You know, the only nagging problem I have, which is kind of more of a holistic problem, is that we've looked better on the road than we have in our own fucking stadium. And that better fucking be different this Saturday when we all watch it on Peacock. So, I don't know. Well, it's late over here. We clearly started the show late, so I think unless anyone else has any final thoughts, Mark, we'll let Red Snapper chime in here. William, I see you got your hand up. Fine, go for it.
Fine.
No one.
That they absolutely get it together.
I mean that's what would make this all go away is just play a complete fucking football game. You know, like put someone away like you did with Purdue. Like midway through the second quarter, Purdue was gone. They were done. That game was fucking over. You know, there's no reason why we couldn't do that to Louisville and expose them. They're ranked higher than us in the AP. They're 15, we're 16. And it's like, really? Why? Based on what? You know, I mean, they put up some good, decent numbers from a statistical standpoint. But look who they played, you know? Like, I don't know. Just Notre Dame, go out there and just do what's right. Whether you have Riley Leonard or Steve Angeli, you know, I think our frustration as fans is that we want Steve Angeli because, and this is kind of natural as fans where you're like, well, we don't see the so-and-so, you know, playing and we want to see him, you know, and it's always that desire to look for the next thing, look for the next best thing. But whether that's Angeli or not, or Minchie or Carr, I don't know. But let's go out there and get it done, you know? I don't know. William, you got your hand up. What's up, man? We'll give you the last bit here.
Last bit. I just want to make sure somebody mentioned that
Riley Leonard has never passed. How can you account for a 22-2 stats of 2,967 passing yards with a 7.62 average with 20 touchdowns with only 6 interceptions? We want to be factual. Let's be factual. He has done it.
Has he done that at Notre Dame?
No.
Okay.
What has he done since
his injury?
That's my point. Everything you guys keep saying just reinforces what I've been saying. Is the guy's in his head. Now, I don't know. I understand people may want to reject that, but I'm telling you, that's the only thing that can be. It's not physical. It's nothing physical wrong with him. It's a mental head. It's in his mental head. And I'm sorry, Starks. I want to be on the record.
We've been talking about sports psychology for a couple weeks now. We've been talking about sports psychology. Maybe it's something mental that's preventing him from getting to the next level. Let me put it this way. Maybe we need Marty McFly to jump in there, you know, dressed like Darth Vader or whatever, to freak the shit out of George McFly, you know, and tell him to take Lorraine to the dance. You know what I'm saying? Like, we need that kind of scare straight bullshit to say, look, man, either put up or shut up or get on the fucking bench and just tell the next guy to go in. Because you going out there and just kind of going through the motions, and that's not what he's doing, right? You know, I'm not trying to be rude, but like, look, man, you're not performing at an excellent level that I need my quarterback to be. You know what I mean? Like, can we just stop the bullshit and stop trying to be nice fans for a tiny second and just be objective? We don't have to be personal with the guy. We don't have to be negative and nasty. But we can say, look, you're just not getting it done. Okay? So maybe if you're really going to be a captain and a real leader, step down. And that takes balls, that takes courage, and true leadership to admit when you're fucking wrong. And that's why I don't throw this on Riley Leonard, I throw this on the fucking coaches. The coaches are the ones who need to recognize that fuck the Notre Dame Illuminati and all this NIL bullshit. We don't even know if that's even real, right? That's quite frankly a rumor. The coaches need to admit that, and maybe it's the inexperience of Marcus Freeman. I don't know. Now with someone like Denbrock, who's been around for fucking ever, you know, or even Gaduli. Or shit, look at Al Golden. Al Golden was a head coach before he decided, hey, I'm going to be a DC.
And that's why he's obviously a better, DC. He admitted to himself that he's a better guy as a DC.
We haven't even talked about this. You know,
we're going to go into it.
We're not going to do this tonight because it's too late. But like,
it's too late.
The best thing about this team is this defense. This defense is fucking amazing. The defense is amazing. Man, that's what we'll title this podcast. The podcast is titled "The Defense is Amazing." Fuck Louisville. We're going to win. The defense is amazing. The defense is amazing.
They're going to be our savior. They're the only one.
And Al Golden, we trust. And I'm not saying we need to fire Marcus Freeman and hire Al Golden.
I don't want Marcus Freeman fired. I'm just saying that all the mistakes that you just previously mentioned from the 10 men on the field and all these other stuff, these things add up. And then somebody's going to say, you know what? This is not working out.
Yeah.
We appreciate your time here. We're going to move in a different direction. It's just logical. I'm sorry. I want this guy to succeed so badly.
Well, sure,
but at some point in time, somebody's going to have to say, like,
we wanted Charlie Weiss to succeed too. You know, that didn't work out either. You know what I'm saying? Like, it doesn't mean we don't want you to try, but at the end of the day, it's like, look, you just didn't do it, you know? And some other team, look, I'll leave it with this. This is real negative. People aren't going to like this. Some other team will be hoisting a trophy, and it won't be Notre Dame.
for another year.
And if that doesn't, that doesn't mean that's this year, but for the last 30 years, it's been the case. If that doesn't piss you off, then what the fuck are you doing here? You know what I'm saying? You gotta dig down deep and take a personal opinion with this. Otherwise, you're just the fucking wine and cheese crowd over at Notre Dame Stadium, and you're leaving in the third quarter like Purdue fans. I'm dead serious when I say that. Okay? Right. Go be a Purdue fan. Leave at halftime. Go to the bars. Okay?
But at the same time, the university needs to stop throwing us pizza parties when it comes to the Shamrock series and this green jersey shit.
Because that's what it is. That's what it is. Yeah.
And it's see how I tied it in for you? It's a fucking pizza party for at work. That's what it amounts up to. You know? So stop giving us pizza parties. We don't want them anymore. We want a fucking championship.
Yeah.
Enough said. Hey, you have a good night. Thanks, Joe. Have Fighting Irish, go Irish.
William, I really appreciate you bringing the heat, bringing the thunder, bringing the hard questions to Notre Dame. And I think this is a really intense show tonight, right? We're over 2 hours in, clearly. But this is a function of the intensity that is Notre Dame right now. And where we are, I do think this game is a crossroads. After this week, we have a bye, thank God. And then, believe it or not, the fucking Stanford game. It's the Stanford game coming up. So we got the Louisville game, then a bye, then Stanford, you know, and anyone who's coming to the Stanford game, obviously we'll talk about that later. But yeah, this is an important game because it's the first like real ranked team in our house. We got bad blood from last year, and we do need to go out there, deliver excellence,
and beat them by 30.
I mean, I'd be okay with that. I'm okay with that.
I'm sorry I had to say it.
No problem.
Well timed. I loved it. I loved it.
All right, we're going to roll with that. I don't think we're going to top that. And quite frankly, I got to go to bed. Let's go, Irish. When does this song play? When the defense is on the field. All this talk about quarterbacks, Marcus Freeman, Illuminati, whatever. What really matters is defense. Defense does win championships, and Notre Dame's defense will limit Louisville. We didn't talk about any of that tonight, but that's what's going to happen. Go Irish.
I want
beat Cardinal. What do you want?
3 interceptions.
All right. I hope so. All right. Wear your green. Game's on Peacock. Go Irish. Beat Louisville.